I'm so glad you could join me. Today, we are covering a request for instruments. And so, I went to a local bookshop and was able to find this comprehensive musical instrument encyclopedia, which I was grateful for. Because I thought maybe I would have to do more individualized books of instruments. So, this is musical instruments. Illustrated encyclopedia with more than 4,000 original drawings. On the front, we have a few instruments. We have a Fender guitar, electric guitar. And this is a very common look for this guitar. Xylophone, it's metal plates, and we have a metronome that keeps the time. If you've ever taken music lessons and are a little bit older, you're probably very familiar with a metronome being set while you're playing. So this was printed in 1976 by Diagram Visual Information in New York. Several different stringed instruments. history, only a very few books have attempted to depict the vast range of man's inventiveness in his search for music-making objects. Michael Pretorius's Syntagma Musicum of 1618 stands as the first major attempt to illustrate and document a large number of instruments. His knowledge, however, was almost entirely restricted to Europe. Today, of course, it is possible to include numerous examples from all corners of the world. In the late 18th and 19th centuries, independent collectors began amassing collections of musical instruments, although their origins and characteristics were often inadequately documented. These instruments became the nucleus of many splendid collections housed in major museums throughout the world. The 20th century brought attempts to develop a comprehensive system of classification for this store of material, and the system of Erika von Hornbostel and Kurt Sachs, which groups instruments according to how the sound is produced, has provided the basis on which our encyclopedia is organized. The variety of instruments is truly staggering, even within one group. For example, the simple tin whistle is shown to be related to the vast church organ. That gives us a little idea of what we're going to look at. Classification. We have mechanical and electrical, chordophones, membranophones, idiophones, and aerophones. And so the contents are divided into each of those different ensembles, makers, virtuosi, writers. Here we have a group of musicians with their trumpets on horses as they're say in a royal display, if I were to guess, announcing someone's presence, a parade, maybe. This section is the aerophones, and in the aerophones they have it divided into blowhole, whistle, single reed, double reed, cup mouthpiece, free reed, and free aerophone. Here we have an example of end, blown, flutes. Fingers from the New Hebrides. salsa from Hungary. This one is more decorative. Even has a, looks like a cattle head on it, a cow. And then other little designs, triangles, imprinted bamboo from Japan. See the segments of bamboo. To it. its body shape, which is globular instead of tubular. The sound is produced by directing the airstream either across the sharp edge of a blowhole, as in the end-blown flute, or into a whistle mouthpiece, as in the whistle flute. Some vessel flutes, for instance the ocarina, have finger holes and sound different pitches. Others are simple whistles and produce only a single note. This one is a Nguru wood Maori whistle, and it's quite decorative. From New Zealand, interesting-looking creature is made of clay from the Aztec Kipactli in the form of a lizard. He has like ears, a snout, eyes, large teeth. Air through the whistling head. So you're blowing in here, it's moving water and then forcing air out through the head. Very interesting. Here we have a whistling pot of clay, also from Peru. And this one is actually in the shape of a person. Sleeves with trim, fingers. They're blowing on a whistle themselves. Their nose and their lips and their eyes, eyebrows, with a decorative hat on. The ears with the hoops in the lobes. I'm assuming they blow into on the back. We have side blown flutes. It's a decorative flute made of clay from Mexico, circa 500 AD. Quite decorative with a person on it. Nose flutes, which always appeared quite funny to me. You have to have some serious sinus power for that. Here we're getting into multiple flutes. That are paired or more than paired, grouped together. Pipes. This one is a wood decorative. Multiple flutes. Some illustrations of people playing large pan flutes. Wood and bamboo versions. We have recorders. In the US, you don't make it out of elementary school without being sent home with a recorder. Well, in some districts, both of my kids had recorders that they brought home occasionally to practice and learn to play. We have a Baroque recorder, consort of Baroque recorders with their pitch ranges. So, the higher the octave, with the smaller the instrument. We have an illustration of a group assuming, musical books in front of them. So that was in the 16th and 17th centuries. Recorders were widely played by groups of amateurs. It's quite ornate. Elaborately carved treble recorder. Many makers in the past went to great lengths to ensure that their appearance of their instruments matched the beautiful sound that they produced. This is quite lovely. Some cross hatching and ribbed pieces. And then it almost looks like fruit that's carved on a vine. Maybe blackberries or raspberries. Then at the top is a potted plant. It looks cactus-like. Flowers. And then there's some numbers and letters at the top. A treble recorder, 19th century, in Brussels. We have flageolets. A whistle flute with a narrow tapering bore was popular in England and France from the 17th to 19th centuries. Orchestral flutes. And they look all very similar. This one has a curve. This one has a side part. Experimental bass flute. This one is an experimental alto flute from London, late 19th century. More. This one's rather interesting. Walking stick flute, late 19th century, Milan. Folk clarinets. We have a North American clarinet. We have a South of some sort. Another clarinet from South America. This is a bumba, an unusual side-blown idioglottal clarinet from Upper Volta. It's made from a millet stalk and has a vibrating reed at one end and one lateral hole at the other. Attached to each end is a small cord pierced with several holes. The hornpipe from South America, the edges are scalloped or fringed. A pipcorn from Wales, a Welsh folk museum, a hornpipe from Greece. Strap to go over your shoulder, and another from India, multiple clarinets. orchestral clarinets that most of us are probably familiar with today. The little pads. Saxophone. Instruments of the Sham family date back to the ancient civilizations of the Middle East and Europe. These instruments were usually played in pairs. Today, folk shawams made of wood or metal are common in Europe, Asia, and parts of Africa. All these instruments, like the modern oboe, have double reeds made from dried cane. Shams produce a strident buzzing tone. Usually played outdoors. Lots of examples of these instruments. Yugoslavia, USSR. Now mind you, this is from 1976, so there were lots of places that were called different things than they are now. We have Tipple, Spain. Shawam-like instrument suitable for indoor use. The first first oboes are thought to have been made by the Hautetaire family and were used by musicians at the court of Louis XIV. They were made in three sections and had accurately calculated bore dimensions and finger hole positions. Lips. Wow, there's some quite beautifully looks rather like a sea creature, or it has fins down here, teeth. Oh my goodness, here's historical trumpets. Look at this one. Cumbersome than straight trumpets and were often designed as decorative objects. So we've got a loop here around. It's rather like a roller coaster over another loop and then the trumpet end. Isn't that beautiful? Here's an 18th century natural trumpet. So it's long. Down, curves back on itself twice. Decorative round piece in the middle. And the end is also quite decorative with metal work. Here we have Celtic carrying from the first century. These trumpets had a characteristic bent back bell in the form of an open mouthed animal. That's amazing. I like how their clothes are almost tartan patterned. Here we have an ancient Assyrian trumpet. Long and straight. Scales. This one's from India. Another copper horn from Tibet. This one is from Bolivia. And is also quite decorative. Lots of different elements on it. This one is also from New Guinea. plus disc action. I can remember playing with some of these when I was a kid. No, that doesn't make me too ancient, but got them from some gift shop or something. But I can remember you would twist it around and around and around and then pull it apart and it would unravel and you'd hear a sound. Humming tops from different cultures. This first one is made from gourd shells, as this one is also. We have a yo-yo with little air holes in the side, so when it goes up and down, it makes a noise. And this was actually quite a popular toy. It was a push top. Stayed on its, but it whirled around and you would make a loud whirring noise from the holes in the side. I remember playing with one of those as well. We have Eastern mouth organs and Western, which most of us know as harmonicas. This one's pretty fascinating. Six-sided harmonica. On the end, it looks like a snowflake or a star. Each harmonica is in a different key. Two large harmonicas played together. We have a piano melodica. Concertinas and accordions. Concertinas, accordions, and melodeons are free reed instruments invented in the first decades of the 19th century. All have end keyboards joined by expandable bellows to drive air over the reeds. Simple models have only a few button or piano keys, whereas concertinas and accordions used by professional entertainers are complex instruments capable of playing music in a variety of styles. Decorative. Concertinas and melodeon. We have the rectangular, more round looking. This is Vienna style honer. The decorative flowers and leaves on each end. The name in the middle. Organs. Part of the pump. A type of water organ invented by Zebios of Alexandria about 250 BC. Here's a portative organ taken from a 14th century manuscript. And this one's quite decorative with scenes on the front of it. Kind of looks like cherub. A little dog figurine on the edge. Oh, here too. And the keyboard in the middle. And then the pipes on the back. Here's a Bible regal. So they used large books or Bibles as the bellows, and you'd pump it with your hands to power the organ part. A positive organ from a 15th century manuscript. manuscript. Positive organs were non-portable flute pipe organs designed for church or home use. A second person operated the bellows. So you've got a person on this side with the bellows, and then the other person on the other side operating the keyboard. Here's more like an organ that we see today in orchestras and churches. Elaborately decorated 17th century organ of the new cathedral, Salamanca, Spain. Many of the front pipes are for decoration only. Very distinctive are the rows of trumpet stop pipes projecting horizontally forward outside the case. Oh, so they're facing us right in front here. And then that is quite ornate with angels. The trumpet, cherubs, lots of faces, and the decorations, winged angels, more figures down below, harmonium. Around.